signed my name to freedom, a memoir of a pioneering life, Betty Reid Soskin, edited by J. Douglas Allen Taylor. In any book about a life that is reaching toward its 10th decade, far more is going to be left out than can possibly be put in. One regret I have is that there was not room enough to put in more about my four wonderful children. Because my eldest, Rick, passed away at such an early age, his life is covered in this book from childhood to the short span of his adulthood. But for Bob, David, and Dorian, only their childhood years appear. David has been dutiful, responsible, and filled with purpose throughout his life. Bob is more of a poet and much more like me, while David is his father personified. As for Dorian, since she was very young, I've been deeply aware of my responsibility to prepare her throughout life for living without me in it. Although she is confident and reasonably talented, the world is simply not designed for her. Signed My Name to Freedom is dedicated to the four of them, Rick, Bob, David, and Dorian, the loves and the pride of my life, with the promise that I will take the time to say more about all of them when I write my next book. Editor's Note. What is the secret of Betty Reid Soskin's great appeal to so many people, both in the country of her birth and around the world? It's a question she and I have been talking over for many years, long before the idea was formed to collect her many writings into a single book about her life. I have known Betty for, literally, my entire life. She's one of my father's cousins who married into my mother's family, so our lives are intertwined on two sides of our families. It was my delight and privilege to witness her rise to national and international fame and prominence over the last decade or so, and to hold many conversations with her discussing how and why this came to be. One thing that should be known about Betty is that she never aspired to fame, has never seen the fame she has attained as the culmination of her life's work. She's constantly both amazed and bewildered by the attention that's paid to her, and certainly in the beginning days of that fame, dearly worried that she could never live up to the expectations people appeared to lay upon her. I can remember several late-night telephone calls with her in those days when, almost in tears, she wondered what she could possibly say in a speech to be given to some organization or other the next morning. And then the morning would come, and she would stand before those upturned, expectant faces and just be Betty, and she gradually realized that this was exactly what they had come for. I'm not at all certain that even to this day, she's fully convinced that what she has had to offer is enough. Because the world did not come to know and appreciate Betty until she was in her 90s, there's a temptation to use her age and her remarkable retention of a youthful and active mind so late in life as the main source of her celebrity, but that's only a small part of it. The elders of our communities are our historians. A historian leads you to the window of the past, presses your nose against the pane, and allows you to see everything that passes by the frame. A good historian walks out the door into the past, walks around, and returns to tell you all he or she has seen so that you can understand what the past was like. A great historian, and Betty Reid Soskin is indeed a great historian, takes you by the hand and walks you through the door of the past and allows you to walk around back there, often as far as your mind can wander, so you can understand what it had been like to live in those years. She puts you in the past and helps you relive it on your own. That's one reason this small, slight, unpretentious woman with a voice that rarely rises above a tone of quiet explanation has been able to captivate thousands in talks and lectures around the country. But another pillar of Betty Reid Soskin's appeal is her unrelenting courage in facing every challenge life places in front of her, whether it is coping with a lifetime of American anti-black racism, raising one developmentally disabled and one gay child, enduring a divorce and a mental breakdown, or beating off a home burglar at the age of 94. It is that stubborn courage that Betty possesses that is captured in the title of this book, Sign My Name to Freedom. The words are the title of a song that Betty typically wrote, not about herself, but about a woman who had signed up during the civil rights era for the freedom struggle in the Deep South. There are two ways that we can sign our names to such a freedom struggle, deliberately or by circumstance. Neither should be considered more courageous than the other. Each requires a different type of courage. The great myth is that the great Rosa Parks took the second way, becoming the symbol of the fight against Jim Crow segregation when she got tired one morning and refused to give up her seat on a Montgomery, Alabama bus to a white passenger. It did not happen that way. Miss Rosa was a secretary of the Montgomery NAACP, and she trained for many months at the Highlander Research and Education Center in Tennessee to prepare for the well-planned action. When she got on the bus that morning, she intended to keep her seat, knowing that she would almost certainly be jailed and possibly suffer even worse. Her actions resulted from a conscious choice to step to the front rank of the fight for freedom. It was Betty Reid Soskin who took the path we mistakenly assigned to Rosa Parks. Betty rarely chose her life's battles in advance, as Rosa did. Instead, she faced them as they came, working, raising a family, choosing a home, operating a business on her own. Her sign-ups for the freedom fight were generally unplanned and spontaneous, and in that, she showed all of us what ordinary citizens facing up to their fears can accomplish. This book was first conceived by Tavis Smiley and Hay House as Betty Reid Soskin's life story in her own words. They had read portions of her blog, CBreaux Speaks, which is faithfully and lovingly followed by thousands around the world, and saw Betty's enormous talent at recounting incidents in her life in powerful, emotional writing. But turning those blog writings into a full autobiography presented a challenge because, just as she used to do with her song composing, Betty writes entirely in the moment. Her writings of past events are caused by emotional triggers, a rediscovered old photograph, an anniversary, a memory suddenly recalled. Her writing process can be described by Omar Khayyam's dictum that, quote, the moving finger writes and having writ moves on. A change made in her writing style to accommodate a full autobiography would rob her writing of all its life and all we have come to value it for, and so a compromise was reached. The early portions of Betty's life, much of what she had not dealt with in her blog, are covered by taking her words from two long interviews she did with the Regional Oral History Office, now the Oral History Center, of the Bancroft Library of the University of California at Berkeley. The remainder of the book consists of excerpts from Betty's blog. Both the interview excerpts and the blog entries have been rearranged in chronological or, at times, subject matter order. Therefore, there are gaps in the narrative of her life. We have tried to bridge those gaps, where appropriate, with editor's notes. The results, we feel, is a beautiful book that fulfills the original promise of telling the story of Betty Reid Soskin's life in Betty's own words. It is my sincere hope that you take as much pleasure in reading it as I derive from whatever small hand I had in bringing it to life. J. Douglas Allen Taylor, Oakland, California, July 2017. Prologue. They're making a film about me. Two films, in fact. One of the fine filmmakers appeared with his team to conduct an on-camera interview to feed into the 30-minute work that is now nearing completion after more than 3 years of shooting. I'm learning a lot about filmmaking in the process, and the producer, Carl Beidelman, tells me that they now have produced about 50 hours of work that, after editing, will become that 30-minute film for the National Park Service. The end may be in sight. The release date has not yet been set as I write this, but I suspect it might well be late fall 2017 or early winter. I imagine that the editing may be the most satisfying part of the process, but I'm projecting here and have no real sense of what really goes into filmmaking. It was fascinating to see them after the actual interview was over and just before the complicated setup of lights and cameras was being disassembled. They called for a hush while the room's ambiance was recorded through the cameras. When questioned, Carl explained that this was needed for the editing, for blending fragments of scenes together without blank silences. After this extended period of being filmed, it doesn't take more than a few minutes to forget the process, the cameras, and hear just the questions, and to react without self-consciousness. I'd never have guessed this would ever be possible, but it most assuredly happens with experience over time. Once those behind the camera have become simply trusted and good friends, eventually, of long standing. What the end result will be, I cannot imagine, but maybe this works for me since I rarely spend much time in yesterday or tomorrow, except when it's called for in my work. There has always simply been now. I suspect that this attitude is a holdover from childhood, just something that I've never outgrown. I've lived my entire life in a constant state of surprise, rarely borrowing from the future or regretting the past, which tends to keep the present always alive and guess-worthy. Anticipation could not have improved this ongoing new reality that sets me right in the middle of the art of others. Something that's become increasingly exciting as I've grown older. I feel like an ever-evolving collaborator in training. The filmmaking has become organic, much as my work with the National Park Service has become over time. There, I'm but one element in the visitor experience, which includes orientation films, life cast figures, documentation of the World War II homefront story, all the works of other rangers, historians, writers, artists, fabricators, lighting designers, etc., and me. It's also true of the book that is set for release in February of 2018, which is being edited by Jesse Douglas Allen Taylor from a combination of my oral histories archived at the Bancroft Library at UC Berkeley and this blog. It is to be published by Hay House out of New York, and it will bring together their writers and editors with my collective words. These often unrelated essays on cabbages and kings at times, pure rants, and sometimes prayers, will become an amalgamation of all those talents and minds, and I will again be a part of something bigger than myself. A thought that has never occurred to me before this very moment. What greater exit from this dimension than to simply disappear into the works of others? That might be the perfect way to move gracefully into whatever immortality there is, just to blend seamlessly into the whole with little notice. Maybe this insight has moved me out from the subconscious to provide a rationale for whatever comes next, whenever. Who on earth would ever have imagined that my little living room would become a movie set on occasion and that I would become, at 95, a star, sitting at my dining room table, comfortable in my socks and non-glamorous cotton trousers, and as relaxed as a cat on a windowsill basking in the noonday sun? Yet, that is precisely where we are in life on this day, June 9th. 2017. This time, I'm adding to the voiceover thread to be filled in behind related images of the other documentary, 90-minute, by Brian Gibble.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.